Thank you very much for the invitation, both Mr. Andonogiannakis and Mr. Brilakis. I was asked to speak about neuromuscular coordination in shoulder instability. So let's start with a statement that the primary role of the shoulder is to place the upper extremity in a position that allows for function of the hand. In order to accommodate this role, the osseous geometry of the glenohumeral joint allows for a high degree of mobility while stability is compromised. Glenohumeral stability is defined as the humeral head stabilization or promptly become to proper alignment within the glenoid fossa throughout an equalization of forces. And it's a complex situation. It needs some a delicate relationship and a fine balance between passive and dynamic components. They are all known, I think. So let's only mention that there are some physical properties that provide stability, meaning adhesion is molecular attraction between the synovial liquid and the chondral surfaces. There is suction due to the sealed environment and negative pressure. As well as there are no ligaments at the shoulder that maintain tension throughout the whole range of motion. They remain loose until a certain point, and then the tension becomes increases suddenly and quickly. So, acting independently, neither dynamic nor passive components can provide stability. The functional integrity of the shoulder needs an interaction between these structures, and this interaction is mediated by the sensory motor system. So, the sensory motor system starts with proprioception. Proprioception includes our ability to determine where our limbs are in space, to detect movement, to appreciate the forces applied, and to appreciate changes in velocity, and originates at the level of mechanically sensitive receptors that transduce the deformity of the tissues as neural signs to the central nervous system through afferent pathways, sensory pathways. At the central nervous system, the proprioceptive input is integrated with vestibular, visual, or other somatosensory input. And the central nervous system, in return, elicits efferent neuromuscular responses, and this is neuromuscular control and its mechanisms. So, forces provided by muscles maintain the humeral hand into the glenoid fossa while they still allow for a high degree of mobility. Many previous speakers show us the Stanmore classification of functioning. I will only mention that that ends to atraumatic structural, traumatic structural, and non-structural lesions. So when injury happens, either by traumatic or atraumatic mechanism, results in functional instability. The physical disruption accompanying the physical disruption, the proprioceptive disruption affects the neuromuscular responses, and this combination results in a functionally unstable joint. So, ultimately, the deficient function may contribute to some re-injury patterns and may account for the high rate of recurrence in shoulder dislocation injuries. So we have a diagram that shows an insidious cyclic role of joint injury on functional stability. Similar to injury, muscle fatigue is believed to affect instability as a complication, either through hindered proprioception and altered neuromuscular responses, either by a decreased ability for an individual to recognize joint position, especially in positions of vulnerability, and as a result, mechanical stress is placed to both structures. So we result in instability again. Results of various studies allow us to note that capsular sensors are not injured or altered in instability. There is certainly a proprioception dysfunction, but it's probably produced by delayed signal production. This leads to uncoordinated mass responses. Other findings suggest that the recruitment is characterized by an asynchronous pattern of activation, especially in relation to the termination of the muscle activity. So we can all remember what Sherrington said, that desistance from action may be as truly active as is the taking of action. This hypothesis of the delay in production of the signal without any significant damage of the sensors confirms the recovery after surgery. So there is evidence to believe that following surgery, the mechanoreceptors may repopulate the capsule, allowing reinnervation as a normal part of the histological healing process. Provided we have great surgeons with great techniques updated, they can restore what can be restored mechanically. And as therapists, we are responsible for function. Mr. Antonogiannakis said so, everyone said so. So we aim to increase the proprioceptive awareness, to facilitate the dynamic stabilization, to restore coordinated activation, muscle activation, and re-educate functional activities. In order to accommodate these goals, we must be able to identify the neuromuscular activations, to be aware of the kinetic change mechanism and the principles of motor learning, to utilize patterns from motor development, we will see that later, and make use of ICF, our new instrument. Let's see those five tools one by one. Neuromuscular activation in a coordinated, sequential, and task-specific pattern is the key for every efficient and effective performance. And shoulder is one of the best examples for the importance of this coordination, muscle coordination, that can optimize function. Altered neuromuscular activations that may account for dysfunction or create a dysfunction. So, while the basics are hardwired into the neuromuscular architecture, they can be improved and considered that as positive adaptations, or can be changed and be less effective through negative maladaptations. Here you can see a usual bad posture, which leads to scapular protraction and internal rotation of the humeral head and decreased compression of the humeral head. The kinetic chain, our body works as an entirety. Rarely do muscles work as individuals. So the general characteristics of each kinetic chain are similar, and there is always one segment, one time of stabilization. So one time showing stabilization, like the famous force couples. There is another phase of stability and motion production, and there is a third phase of the third time of proximal stability in order motion and forces to go to the next segment. Like throwing, we need core stability and hip stability in order to throw. The attainment of any motor skill involves a process of motor learning. Optimal theory in 2016 demonstrates that any advantages seen under autonomy, supportive, and self-control conditions are motivated in nature. What does it mean? That means that if I want to make a move, and this move is successful, and this success is recognized, then all the neuromuscular activity that accompanies this movement is transported to the brain as a motor memory. Here are our first movements. So we have a sequence of movements an infant learns. And the stabilization of the shoulder girdle is one of the great one of them. We start to stabilize our scapula and our shoulder girdle even at 4 or 5 months of age. So infants during the first year of their life use the upper extremities for any activity, even walking. They walk using hands. And what they do, they perform a closed kinetic chain training and provide brain the ability to create neural pathways and connect muscle contractions and generate movement. So as we become older and move more like robots, our brain tends to forget these neural pathways and how to efficiently activate them. So a rehabilitation program with some of that movements may maximize the body's exertion, and this may be the key for more efficient performance. ICF, you all know ICD, and ICD-10, maybe. ICF is the International Classification of Functioning, Disability and Health, proposed by the World Health Organization, and proposes us a diagram in which the left part, body function and structures, are not the only factor that refers to activity and health condition, but also lists the level of participation, the environment, and personal factors. So, What does ICF? ICF provides us a description of situations with regard to human functioning and its restrictions, and serves for us as a framework to discuss and to classify the contribution of an individual's physical properties or environment on their health status. Some piece of advice would be to spend time to observe carefully, to evaluate, to reassess if it's necessary. Always set priorities, not only for achievements, but only for the impairments. Maybe there are more than one impairment. To start with slow, precise movements and stop when fatigue evident. To ensure correct movement patterns and watch for incorrect. In order to do that, we can break complex movements patterns into simple ones. And don't forget to go back to basics, because it's better train smart, not hard. So, as I mentioned at the beginning, the role of the shoulder is to be as much stable and as much mobile as needed for the hand to be functional. So, shoulder's integrity is essential to gain an Olympic medal, to do a job, or to keep the house, but as well as it's very essential for having fun with children, to create art, to express passion, or even love. Thank you.